There's a lot of exploration of, you know, kinesthetic and audio and, you know, haptic technology and research labs. And there are some examples of it kind of penetrating the mainstream, like video game controllers vibrate and like that's like a haptic interaction and things like that. Fundamentally, in terms of our awareness and our attention, technology is kind of like an extension of our minds, right? If you think about technology the way cyborg anthropologists think about it, which is best job title in the world, by the way, cyborg anthropologist. But the way cyborg anthropologists think about it is that we sort of kind of extend our capacities with technology. And so the hammer is an extension of the arm. Like I can hit something, I've developed this hammer to hit it harder, right? And you know, the car or the bicycle is an extension of your legs. This, they get me from point A to point B. I build this technology, I get from point A to point B better. And the kitchen is an extension of your digestive system. It's like, I've got this tool to digest and break down food. Well, with a little bit of cooking, a little bit of cutting, I can kind of augment my digestive system. And so these more recent technologies are extensions of thinking, of the thinking mind, of the conceptual mind. They're largely in this domain of mind. And so that's very empowering, as we know. This world we live in is like we're empowered with a collective network of thought, really. The world's information at our fingertips, right? At the same time, we've kind of opened the back door to all our minds so that it's easy to influence our minds, easier than it ever has been before. Targeted advertising and, you know, filter bubbles and news feeds and things like that. The thing that's really interesting about this, though, from a meditation perspective, is a meditation master would tell you that without any technology, we're already super distracted all the time, right? Like you just walk down the street and you've got a million thoughts going a minute. You add a podcast to that, you add a phone to that, you add a haptic interface, whatever interface you want, whether it's audio or visual, it's not really changing the status quo that much. In some ways, it's making it a little more aggressive and unstoppable. It's also adding new external content into your mind. But on the realm of distraction and attention, I mean, whether someone's walking without their headphones or with their headphones, I mean, you don't judge either of them because odds are they're both rolling in thought, right? So the practices don't change in terms of their relevance. But I think what really changes is when a lot of the thoughts that are coming through our minds become more problematic, and we really are seeing a mental health crisis over the past 10 years, and we think about depression, we think about anxiety, we think about psychosis and schizophrenia. If you think really closely about these conditions, they're all conditions where the large manifestation is in your inner voice. You know, so if you're depressed, you go through negative spirals of negative self-talk. Anxious people are ruminating on threat detection. You know, schizophrenics have displaced the voice in their head and attributing some external causality to it, et cetera, et cetera. So technology is adding to that mess where you've got all these external voices that are coming in your head and it's becoming harder and harder to sort that out. So it's not that attention practices were less relevant before and they're more relevant now. They were always relevant. That's why they were discovered 2,000 years ago. The difference is now there is so much, you know, more to be gained from gaining clarity because there's so much more to parse through. There's so much more noise in that sort of cyclone of thinking. And a lot of it is not coming from your authentic self. If you imagine someone 2,000 years ago, they're meditating with those thoughts, and those thoughts are largely just coming from their daily life. Someone today, same thing, meditating with thoughts, but half of those thoughts aren't even yours, and half is being generous, right? Like, you ask me about any public issue, and I'm likely to parrot the last headline I read. It's not even my thought. The concept of the self as it relates to our interconnected web of technology, you have to remember that this technology is designed, and it's designed by people. And so when you ask, like, is this technology, in some ways we're interconnected with the world, there's a kind of like dissolution of the self and a kind of universal oneness to that. My answer would be, there could be if we designed our technology better. But fundamentally, a lot of the technology we've designed has been designed really from the place of in extreme selfishness and ego. And so it promotes extreme selfishness and ego. Whereas, yes, I'm connected around the world, every pipe that I connect to people through is promoting me to be more self-involved and more concerned about how I'm appearing through these pipes, spending like half a day working on my profile. And when's the last time anyone spent 20 minutes on Twitter sharing kindness? But this is the thing that the designer has the lens on that most people don't when it comes to technology, is that we just assume technology is the way it is, but designers know we made it that way for a reason, right? These technologies are made this way because they're designed to maximize screen time, which gets more advertising revenue, which generates more profit for the corporation, so the corporations are bigger. That is not a recipe for selfless or self-dissolving technologies. We have yet to find the recipe for that, but I think when I wake up at night, the thing that gets me up is the possibility of that. And I'm well into my career enough to know that I've worked on a number of projects that have made a drop in that ocean, that I've created things and worked with teams to create things that have connected people more than separated them. And that gives me a sort of position to look at most technologies we use and say, most technologies are separating us more. And if that feels abstract, the most concrete example is the incredible effect of social media on political polarization. It's very difficult to make an argument that social media is connecting us in a kind of ubiquitous, like unified consciousness. When you look at the main effect of social media on civilized discourse is polarization. It's actually driving us to be a more nationalist, more divisive society. So it could be that. I hope it one day will be that, but it's quite the opposite right now.